Dear colleagues, one second. Thank you very much for the opportunity to give some aspects from mucosal melanoma. I have nothing to disclose. There are, of course, several locations of mucosal melanoma possible in the head and neck area. Most common are mucosal melanomas in the sinonasal tract, also in the nasal cavity. Sometimes we see them in the oral cavity and more rare in the pharynx or the larynx, very rare in the temporal bone. Mucosal melanoma, I will focus first on the history, then on the epidemiology, the genesis, the therapy, and finally on the prognosis. The first case of a mucosal melanoma was described in the German literature by Weber, 1859. Then it was classified as a distinct entity in 1869 by Luke as a melanotic sarcoma which arose from the nasal mucous membrane. The first case in the US literature of a mucosal melanoma in the head and neck was described by Lincoln in 1885. And in 1960, the first comprehensive literature review on head and neck mucosal melanomas was performed, identifying 117 cases. The predominance of this disease is in the sinonasal region. Between 59 and 80% of the cases compared with the oral region and other sites, like I mentioned before. The overall survival is very poor, with a reported 5-year overall survival for all stages ranging from 20 to 48%. I want to continue with the incidence of mucosal melanoma, and I will give a report on some literature analysis. First, there is a very important paper from the European view, published in 2012 by Malone and co-workers, as descriptive epidemiology of malignant mucosa and uveal melanomas and adnexal skin carcinomas in Europe. They could show that in the European Union, about 1,300 cases are expected to receive the diagnosis of mucosal melanoma per year. Head and neck mucosal melanomas are of this population in 40%, mucosal melanomas of the female genital tract in 36%, and mucosal melanomas of the anal canal colorectal tract in about 18 to 20%. The incidence is 2.0 per million per year, and male are less affected than female. Then there are some regional differences. For example, in Japan, mucosal melanomas 22 to 32% of all melanomas, oral mucosal melanomas 7.5% of all melanomas, and 35% of mucosal melanomas. Caucasians, oral mucosal melanomas 1% of all melanomas and 3.6% of mucosal melanomas. There is another paper from 1997. This described for the black race oral mucosal melanomas 1.7% of all melanomas, and for especially Uganda Africans, sinonasal melanomas 2.6% of all melanomas. A paper published in 2012 could show that the incidence of mucosal melanomas increased 2.4% per year from 1987 to 2009 in the US. nasal cavity lesions, so also sinonasal melanomas, increased in incidence, whereas the incidence of non-nasal cavity lesions remained stable. The highest rate of increase was in white females ages 55 to 84. I will continue with the genesis of mucosal melanomas. Etiopathogenesis of mucosal melanomas is still mostly unknown. It is known that melanocytes move into the entodermally as well as ectodermally developed mucosa. The function of these mucosal melanocytes is mainly unknown. In locations with melanosis, so pigmentation of the oral mucosa often observed in colored people, mucosal melanomas occur more often. Melanomas in the sinonasal area, in the sinonasal area occur rather rarely, so it is supposed that such melanomas originate a previously existing lesion. You see in this slide, one second, here there is a melanosis also in the nasal cavity. Then there is another important paper published in 2013 by Fernie and co-workers in the Journal of Pathology about genome sequencing of mucosal melanomas. They analyzed 5 metastatic mucosal melanomas of the nasal cavity, the gastrointestinal tract, and the urogenital tract. The samples analyzed by whole genome sequencing harbored on average 8,000 somatic single nucleotide variants per tumor compared with an average of 86,000 SNVs per tumors in cutaneous melanoma. Mucosal melanomas have a considerably higher number of structural variants than cutaneous melanomas. The somatic mutation rates in mucosal melanomas were 5- to 10-fold lower than in cutaneous melanomas and lung cancer, but similar to that of cancers not associated with exposure to known environmental mutagens like prostate and breast cancer. The low mutation burden and lack of a specific mutation pattern suggest that mucosal melanomas is not generally associated with exposure to UV light or cigarette smoke, and the mechanisms underlying the genesis of mucosal melanomas are distinct from those of common cutaneous melanoma, the cause of chromosomal instability in the mucosal melanoma samples is not clear, and there were no recurrent mutations in genes involved in maintenance of genome integrity. So we will continue with the role of c-Kit in mucosal melanomas, and this may be a target for therapy with tyrosine kinase inhibitors. So this is a list, and you see that there are a lot of papers in the meantime treated with imatinib or sorafenib, and of course it was always a small population, some cases, but it may be that this play in the future an important role. I will focus on 3 papers. First, paper of Zetzka from the British Journal of Cancer about a German population. They analyzed 44 specimens of 39 patients with mucosal melanoma of different locations, and the conclusion was that KIT mutations can be found in a subset of patients with mucosal melanomas irrespective of the location of the primary tumor. Another population analyzed in Russia, 48 mucosal melanomas were analyzed for the presence of c-KIT mutations. They summarized a substantial portion of mucosal melanoma carry a therapeutically relevant mutation in the KIT oncogene. And at the end, in this context, I will cite a paper about a population in Italy. They analyzed 11 cyanonasal melanomas, and the conclusion was mutations of c-KIT are infrequent in cyanonasal melanoma in southern Italy, but of course it was only a population of 11 patients. What do we know from the NCCN guidelines? Surgery is the primary treatment for mucosal melanomas, stage 3 through 4A. In most cases, adjuvant radiotherapy seems effective in improving local control and survival. Survival rates of surgery alone or surgery combined with radiation therapy are better than those after radiation therapy alone. And c-KIT inhibitors like imatinib may be useful in patients with metastatic mucosal melanoma and c-KIT mutations. Neck dissection and postoperative radiation are recommended for clinical nodal disease. In mucosal melanoma, no evidence shows that the depth of invasion predicts occult metastatic disease, although the risk likely does increase with increasing depth. And elective neck dissection should not be performed for mucosal melanoma, except for the oral cavity, where the likelihood of positive disease is significantly higher. Elective neck dissection are generally selective, preserving all major structures unless operative findings dictate otherwise. What do we know about the prognosis? 5-year survival according to the localization of the primary tumor, mucosal melanoma of the female genital tract has a prognosis of 43.9%, of the head and neck, 25.5%, and of the anal canal colorectal tract, 19%. Here you see some slides. This is the significant difference for the prognosis between the nasal cavity and the oral cavity, so areas where you can identify these tumors more easily. And on the opposite side, the nasopharynx or the oropharynx or the paranasal sinuses. Here is the significant difference between the age, less than 50 and 60 to 69, compared to an age above 70 years. What's about the tumor side? Again, a significant difference between a lower tumor side, less than 2 centimeters, compared to more than 4 centimeters. Nodal status at presentation, the negative group, and on the other side, the positive group, and the same is true for distant metastasis, significant difference, non or present distant metastasis. Here the survival treatment, on the one side surgery or surgery and radiation therapy compared to no treatment, of course, or radiation alone. Let me conclude. Mucosal melanomas are an extremely rare entity encountered mainly in the cyanonasal tract and the oral cavity, showing a poor 5-year survival rate. The incidence of cyanogenesis mucosal melanoma is rising, and current treatment consists mainly of surgery while radiation and chemotherapy are still controversial. We have a lot of work to do. Conclusion, second, no elective neck dissection except for the oral cavity. A neck dissection should be performed in patients with lymph node metastasis without distant metastasis. Neck dissection and postoperative radiation are recommended, as I said before, for mucosal melanoma with clinical nodal disease. Pembrolizumab as a promising target therapy in cutaneous melanoma, I think, is not well known now from the effect from mucosal melanoma, but there are some experts that did not expect high benefit for this in mucosal melanoma. And a higher proportion of KIT mutations and lower proportion of BRAF mutations in mucosal melanomas may help us in the future. We need definitely clinical trials for all patients with mucosal melanomas. These are necessary to better define the treatment choices of all stages of the disease. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. Is there any questions for Professor Werner? We have a few minutes before we go on to the next speaker. It's certainly a dismal disease to treat, and perhaps Paul Chapman would like to, before he starts his talk, might give us some ideas about what other adjuvant trials we could, as a group, endeavour to perform in this group of patients. Yes, one question.
Thank you for your excellent talk. Arupan Wal from University of Nebraska in Omaha. In clinically node negative patients with mucosal melanomas, where do you see the role for PET CT scan or systemic workup upfront? Because that's something that's still, unclear, at least in my practice, where do you stand?
I think it may, of course, be helpful. It depends on the location where you are. Probably in your institution, it's not very difficult to get this. I think in other institutions, it is also today still difficult. Probably for mucosal melanoma, we should do nearly everything to identify the real situation because of this very bad prognosis. Yeah. And if this may help, let's try it.
Thank you.
One of the problems that we see is the multifocality of lesions, particularly in the sinonasal tract.
Yes.
So what's your approach to managing lesions in terms of the margins of the excision, and do you strip the mucosal membranes? How do you approach this?
This is, I think, the most important question for this location. So what we try is, of course, to remove the tumor. Yeah? But this is, of course, not possible in all cases, because sometimes some satellites are also up to the narrow nasopharynx, for example. This is the reason why we combine, in the most cases, in this rare disease, surgery and radiation therapy. But if there is a recurrence, we will go back again and remove this, and do this, of course, again and again, because I think this is the only way to control, at the end, recurrences. And this we should do very early, before there is a deep infiltration of the skull base and the orbit.
And would you approach that endoscopically or using an open approach?
I think this depends again, as usually, on the experience of the surgeon. So I think the endoscopic approach in mucosal melanoma is really difficult, because it is, of course, difficult as a procedure. And in this area, I think we should at least, or we would try to open this and to remove this, and not only endoscopically. Yeah. But for recurrent situation, we can do this.
Okay, thank you very much. If we have no further questions, we'll move on to our final speaker,